Spread the fire. Welcome back to SMWX, and I'm here with a very respectable gentleman. I don't know him very well, but very nice to meet you, Advocate Mpofu.
Very nice to meet you, young gentleman.
Dad, wow. Tshela, Thupa has just concluded. How are you feeling as we're going into this election? You know, I get to see up close the toll it takes on a person who's right at the forefront. But how are you feeling at this historic moment in our nation?
Well, Sizwe, a lot of history is being made today. Part of it is the fact that you are interviewing me. Yeah. That is a history on its own. But be that as it may, it's a very significant day. I think as the president of the EFF said, this is a watershed election. It's very important that to understand that for black people, really, there are two choices. It's the ANC or the EFF. Forget about the other rats and mice. The message is very clear. If you vote for the ANC, you are voting for continued strife, for continued corruption, for continued devastation, for continued white supremacy, and really for no change except for a reversal of the inequality that we have had. On the other hand, if you vote for the EFF, you are voting for the future, you are voting for youth, you are voting for women, you are voting for the land, you are voting for free education, very important. Because we don't believe that economic empowerment of black people will come through BEE schemes that will make Ramaphosa's and Motsepe's rich, but through education. And, we're always asked, at least I know that your platform has got some intellectual capacity. Even if I say so myself.
Something for other platforms.
Exactly.
But this one.
I don't know where you got it from. Yeah. But on a serious note, what people say to us, for example, when we talk about our manifesto, where's the money going to come from?
Yeah.
You say you're going to double grants, you say you're going to have free education, you're going to have free health.
Yeah.
But that's because South Africans are not thinking critically. Because I was saying to somebody yesterday, do you know that you can double social grants without actually putting a one cent on the budget by simply halving the number of recipients? How do you halve the number of recipients? By making sure that there are job opportunities, by massive industrialization, by making sure that we work the land. So these are not miracles. These are things that can be done. The money is there. Anybody who asks, where's the money going to come from, is a lazy thinker. Because you and I give the government in tax about 1.5 trillion rand every year, every 12 months. And you still ask me, where's the money going to come from? All we ask for a government is to use that money to benefit the people of South Africa, to think in the long term, to invest in the future of our nation. It's really not rocket science. But one thing for sure is that the status quo will never resolve anything.
So, I know that your political journey was really fundamentally shaped by Marikana. Obviously, you represented the injured and arrested miners, and you saw up close what that was like. Take us through the political moment of Marikana and how that led you to the EFF, and also where we are right now with the question of Marikana right in front of this election.
Yeah, well, Marikana was the last straw for me, or at least it was one of the main last straws. If you remember, I wrote an article when I joined the EFF where I cited three things that made me take this decision. One was Marikana, the second one was the ill-treatment of the Youth League and the decimation of the Youth League. And the third one was the adoption by the ANC of the National Development Plan, a plan that clearly will never work for South Africa. And I made those, ironically, in all those three things, whether it's Marikana, the Youth League, or the NDP, there's one central figure who looms large, Cyril Ramaphosa. And therefore, that moment, for me, this moment where South Africa might make a mistake of entrusting a person whose economic vision is bankrupt, who decimated young people, and who contributed to the murder of miners in Marikana, is something that pains me. But we have to be patient with our people. Over time, our message will resonate with them. So yes, Marikana was a significant watershed, just as in the 60s, Sharpeville was a significant watershed for many people.
And obviously after this election, the big talk is the question of coalitions. What's your thinking around that question? Look, obviously it's a dynamic thing and we don't know what's going to happen, but what kind of principles will inform your negotiating position?
Look, our position on coalitions is very, very, very simple. We have articulated it time and again. We had a press conference, if you remember, in 2016 in Alexander. We articulated our position. It's simply this. Any party, whether it's the ANC, whether it's the XYZ party, that will meet our demands, namely land expropriation, the nationalization, free education, and all the things that everybody knows by now. We've added a few things like the national anthem, the airport in Cape Town, and so on. Anybody who meets those conditions, it doesn't matter who they are, we'll sign tomorrow. We'll sign a coalition agreement. However, if, as in 2016, no party meets those demands, then we have to apply our mind to see what is the best outcome. In 2016, it was to make sure that the ANC is rooted out and that the Zuma regime collapses. And it was a tactical decision. Remember, the principle, we had already lost on the principle because none of the parties agreed to our demands. So it's the same now. Firstly, coalitions, we can't discuss coalitions. Coalitions will only happen if the people themselves impose coalitions on us, so to speak, by not voting an outright winner. In that eventuality, we'll follow the same pattern. Put the demands. If you meet them, well and good, we hug and kiss. If you don't meet them, we show you the door. And then we will ourselves now have to see what is best for our people. What we did in 2016 was then to say we will leverage our vote and leverage it for the benefit of our people.
And I think a lot of people haven't realized that all the leverage from 2016 is still there. And now there's going to be new leverage in provinces.
Well, now the leverage is even bigger because although these are provincial and national elections, obviously when we negotiate or if we negotiate, we're going to put on the table everything. Tshwane, Johannesburg, Nelson Mandela Bay, other places. So it's going to be a very interesting thing. Our principle even there is simple. What is the best advantage? I was saying this morning in another interview, even if we get one vote, literally one vote, your vote or my vote, we will leverage that vote for the African masses, for black women, for the downtrodden, as we have done in Johannesburg, where we said to Mashaba, okay, you want our vote for the budget, insource your security guards, insource your cleaners. We did the same in Tshwane. As a result, thousands of people now have medical aid, double salary, and so on. And that's what we will do.
And just finally, this has been a time for grief in the EFF. We went through our own period of grief in our family, and I recall the CIC being there for us when we lost Mamdolo. The CIC is going through a great period of grief. What's that been like for the leadership at this incredibly important moment for you as a party personally, and then a tragedy and tragedies that have rippled through the leadership at the same time? Take us into what it's been like as a EFF leadership core.
Thank you. You know, that's a very important issue because I describe today as a bittersweet moment, because obviously it was planned to be a festival, a celebration. And yet, yesterday we were then hit with this sad news of the passing away of Koko Sarah Malema. Look, it was, as you say, you and I have just gone through a similar episode a few months ago. And therefore, for me personally, it was very difficult to relate to the moment because I was just reliving to say, what must the president of the EFF be going through? Because I know what the first 24 hours is like. I know what the first 48 hours is like. So still fresh in my mind. And so when we went, we spent some quiet moments with him yesterday, 3 to 4 hours. And as I reported, at the end of that, the men just stood up and said, comrades, let's go to see if the stadium is ready. And we came here, we left here at about midnight or 1 a.m. And then we knew. The answer was there because we didn't know what to say. Well, we're going to say to him, are you going to make the speech? Are you ready? And the signal was there to use a local language of this stadium.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, all I can say is I know how hard it is to negotiate with you because I've been doing it all my life.
Yeah.
And good luck to anyone on the opposite end of those coalition negotiations.
Yeah, well, thank you. Yeah, well, if the other negotiators know what to do, they must come to you for advice. Otherwise, like you, they will come second.
Love you, Dan. Thanks
okay,
so
boy,
much.
Love you, boy. Well done. Watch SMWX.
SMWX.